This conference will now be recorded.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Research Methodology Lecture Series. I hope you liked the yesterday session, and today is the third day of our lecture series. The topic of today's session is Analytical Study, Data Collection and Data Analysis, which is going to be presented by Dr. Nilima Narayan Rao Wadnerwar, ma'am. She has completed her BMS, MD in Agar Tantra, also done fellowship in ethnopharmacology, and she is a PhD scholar. At present, she is an associate professor in Agar Tantra and HOD in research methodology and medical statistics in Mahatma Gandhi Ayurveda College Hospital and Research Center, Salod, Hirapur, Wardha. She has a teaching experience of 10 years for UG, 6 years for PG, 2 years for PhD. She is a member of Institutional Forum for Women, Datta Mege Institute of Medical Sciences, DU, since 2014. She is invited as guest speaker in various national and international webinar and conferences. She served as chairperson and co-chairperson in various seminar and conferences. She has published 30 research papers in national and international Scopus and Web of Science Index journals, 6 research projects and 12 student research projects, UG, PG and PhD, running under her supervision. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Nilima Narayan Rao Wadnerwar, ma'am, to present today's session on the topic of analytical study, data collection and data analysis, and its role in research field for the student. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Is the screen visible?
No, ma'am.
Now?
Yes, ma'am. It's visible now.
Good afternoon to one and all. Myself, Dr. Nilima Wadnerwar. Madam has given a very informative information about me. So I will directly start the topic. Today's topic is analytical study designs, data collection and data analysis. I must tell you that both these topics are different and they are not having any connection with each other. So we will discuss these topics. Please inform me if the slides are not changeable. Can you see the next slide?
No, ma'am.
You are not able to see?
No.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible now.
Just a minute. I will share another slide. So the objectives of the today's presentation is to understand the analytical study designs, and secondly, to study the methods of data collection and data analysis. So we will see one by one. Firstly, we will know what is the aim of the study designs. why we are discussing about the study designs. From yesterday you have started about the study designs. So when you want to generate or formulate a new hypothesis, you will have to design the descriptive studies. And when you want to test the generated hypothesis, you will have to design the analytical studies. And when you want to prove the tested hypothesis, in that case, you will have to design the experimental studies. So the study designs are according to the aim with which we are going to conduct. In the classification of study designs, you have learned about the observational and non-observational study designs. In the observational study designs, we have the descriptive and analytical studies. And in the analytical studies, there are two types of studies, that is the case control and cohort study design. In the case control study, as the name reflects, there are two groups. One is the case group and another is the control group. So these type of studies are very simple type of studies and they are economical. Ma'am. Means they are not, huh?
Ma'am, your slides Hello? Are not visible.
Okay.
Slides, yes ma'am, they are not moving actually. Slides are visible, but they are not moving. Yes ma'am. Yes.
Now, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Is it changing?
Yes, ma'am.
So these are the very simple and economical type of study because more funds are not required for these studies. So these studies are increasingly used to investigate the cause of the disease. When the disease is already occurred in case of especially the rare diseases. So in the rare diseases, we have to find out the causes of the disease. Means the disease process and causes, they have already occurred in the past. So for this study design, we have to select a group of people which is called as cases. The participants with a desired disease means on which we want to conduct a study. So that kind of participants are involved in the case group, and the control group involves the participants who are not having that particular disease or that particular outcome variable. So with these two groups, we are comparing the outcome in the both the groups. In this study designs, the occurrence of possible causes is compared with the cases and controls. And these are also known as retrospective studies because the researcher is looking backward from the disease to a possible outcome. Means already the disease has occurred in the population, that possible causes, they are also occurred in that participants. Now we are finding the exposure, we are finding the causes of that particular disease. So we have to look backward from effect to cause. That is why these studies are called as the retrospective studies. The most important thing in the study design is the cases and control should be from the same place or same population. If you are conducting a study in your hospital, in that case, your cases will be from your hospital only and your control will be from your hospital only. The patients coming to your hospital will be included in the cases and control group because the matching of these cases and control is the heart of the study design. So both exposure and outcome these are already occurred before the start of the study. And now we are using the control group for the comparison purpose, because involving a control group, it increases the strength of your study. When you are comparing one group with the other, then the comparison makes the final result, final conclusion more strong. So in this study design, we are selecting the cases and control from the defined population. Whatever the population we want to study, we are taking the participants and we are categorizing the participant in the two groups. The desired disease is selected, and the participants who are having the disease, they are involved in the case group, and the participants who are not having the disease, they are controlled, they are involved in the control group. And the researcher is making a inquiry in the forward direction. You can see the arrow, but the time is in the backward direction, means the disease is already occurred and the causes, they are already occurred in the past. So it is a backward movement and the inquiry is in the forward movement, forward direction. So now we are inquiring the both the groups, participants of the both the groups, whether they are having the particular causes or not. Means whether the participants having the disease in the case group, they are exposed to the cause, or the participants who are not exposed to the cause, but they are having the disease. Similarly, in the control group, we have to search for the participants who are not having the disease, but having the causes, same causes, means they are exposed, and the participants, some will be not having the disease, but they are not exposed to that causes, means they are not having disease as well as they are not having the causes. So this kind of four types of participants we will get from the cases and control group. Here is the example of case control study. The study is to find out the causes of the neonatal death. Neonatal death is defined as the death which is caused in the time period after the delivery, that is 1 month after the delivery. So the cases will be children who died within the first month of the delivery, and the control will be children who survived during that first month of the life, and there will be comparison between these two groups. So in the methodology, we will have to take the interview of the mothers for having the history regarding various aspects like antenatal care, then the postnatal care, then the things or happenings, occurrences in the delivery. So all the things will be interviewed to the mother, and the outcome analysis will be conducted to determine the certain risk factors which are more prevalent among the children who died due to the this particular period. So this will help us to find out the causes of the neonatal death, as well as we can use that causes to prevent the neonatal death. So in this study design, we have to use the standard 2-into-2 contingency table. Means one cause we have selected, and we have to look for the presence and absence of that cause in the with respect to the disease. Means the here you can see the values like ABCD. So the A represent the number of participants who are having the cause as well as who are having the disease. B represents the participants who are having the cause but they are not having the disease. Then C represents the participants who are not having the cause but they are having the disease, and the D represents the participants who are not having the cause and who are not having the disease. This technique helps us to exclude the other possibilities. Means one in the routine course we find that one cause can cause the many more diseases, and one disease can be caused by the many more causes. So to exclude the other possibilities, we have to use this 2x2 contingency table. Now some highlights regarding the case control study. In this study, the selection as well as recall bias is high, and I think this is a disadvantage of this study, because when we want to conduct the inquiry regarding the past events, the participants may forget about the events, or they cannot recall the whole things, whole history or whole causes of the particular event. So this kind of bias is high. And there is the second thing is loss to follow up is very low. If we compare this thing with the other study designs, in that case we don't need follow up much more. So the possibility of loss to follow up is low. Then the confounding factors. Confounding factors are the factors which can confuse, which can create the mess in the study. These type of factors, they are medium in the study. They are not less and they are not high. The time required for this study is medium. So much more time is not required. In specific time period, we can finish this study. The cost is also medium. Investigation of rare diseases is high. Means from this type of study designs, we can investigate the cause of the rare disease. To prove causation of disease is moderate. Means if you want to prove the cause and effect relationship or cause of the disease, for that purpose, you will have to conduct the experimental studies. Means you have to conduct the RCT, randomized control trial, because they are the studies which are having strong, means they are the strength. They are having the strength to prove this causation of the disease. And this type of study design require small sample size. Not much sample is required. The participants required for this study is very low. Next type of study design is the cohort study design from the analytical study. Cohort means a group of persons which are having the common statistical characteristics like age, the date of birth, the year of marriage, group of people having exposed to common events like cyclone, earthquake, tsunami, plane crash, railway accidents, etc. These kind of studies are called as the follow-up study, because in this study we are having follow-up of the participants. These are also called as longitudinal study or long-term study, because these studies are conducted for years, more than 3 years. These are also called as prospective study, because we are looking forward. In the case control study, that was the retrospective study, because we were looking backward, means from the disease to exposure. Now we are looking from exposure to the disease or outcome. That is why this is the prospective study. And this is also called as incident study, because in this type of study, we are finding the frequency of the disease. Means after having the cause, the disease can occur how much frequently. So with this, we can estimate the incidence of the disease. Cohort studies are the observational epidemiological study which attempts to study the relationship between cause and risk of developing disease. Means once we are exposed to the cause, how much risk of developing that disease we can predict by taking this cohort study or by taking this longitudinal study. The characteristics of the cohort studies includes, these are the exposure based groups. Means whatever the groups are selected, they should have the exposure, they should have the causes, they should be they should have faced some experience. Means just like cyclone or just like tsunami or any other accident or occurrence. these are the long term or longitudinal study to determine the frequency of the disease. But though it is long term, it should have a definite beginning and definite end, because we cannot continue this study for years together. Mostly 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, these are the common period in these studies, because we have to take follow up of the participants, and we cannot follow the participants for longer period, and there are chances of losing the follow up. So if it is having definite end, then the study will give you benefit. There should be good evidence of exposure and disease, means you should have more participants for the causes, as well as you should have more participants for the diseases. For estimating the result and for finalizing the conclusions, we should have ample amount of sample size as a evidence. Exposure should be rare, means the causes should be rare, but the incidence of disease should be higher among the exposed. If it is, if the disease is rare, we cannot undertake the follow-up and we cannot have the findings. So it is necessary that the incidence of the disease should be higher. Mostly we have to select the common outcomes. The study gives you benefit when the outcomes are common. Many different outcomes for same exposure. For one cause, if they are having many more diseases, then the study gives you benefit. Follow-up should be easy. This topic is related with the next topic, that is, cohort should be stable. If you are involving some group of people who are migrants, just like students, students are coming for education from different states and different countries. They are completing their education and going to their places. If we are involving such students in the study, we will lose them to for the follow-up. Similarly, the tribes which are wandering from one place to another, they are wandering according to the season. So if we are involving such tribes in the study, we will lose them for the follow-up. So your cohort should be stable, means your cohort should be available for the whole study, whole period of the study. That is why we have to select the cohort according to the follow-up of the study. Then funds should be more, as the studies are conducted for years. So according to year and according to the follow-up of frequency of the follow-up, you are requiring the fund for the study. So this kind of studies, they require more fund. Should estimate incidence within risk factor groups. But this type of studies cannot estimate prevalence of risk factor. So for the prevalence of risk factor, we have to conduct the another type of studies. Only we can estimate the frequency of the disease and incidence of the disease. Now these are the steps in the cohort study. In very simple steps, we can conduct this study. Firstly, you have to select a suitable study for which you want to conduct. Then you can select a disease and you have to select the cohort. So in the cohort, you will have to select the case cohort as well as the control cohort. Then from the selected cohort, you will have to collect the data. All the observations, they should be collected, and according to your questionnaire, according to your pro forma, and the collected observations should be analyzed for the outcome. And whenever you required follow up, you have to follow the cohort. So as many as follow up are there, all the observations from the follow up, they are involved in the study, and finally we have to measure the outcome. The salient features of the cohort study involves the selection bias and recall bias are very low, because we are ourselves following the study. We are ourselves going to the field and taking the follow-up from the participants and collecting the information. So this is a future-based study. So there are very less chances of recall bias. Loss to follow-up is very high, because if the study conducts for longer period, there are more chances to lose the follow-up. The confounding factors are very low, but the time required is very high, because the studies are conducted for years together. As the studies are conducted for many years, the cost is also high. The cost will be applicable for the follow-up as well as for the conduction of the whole study. We can investigate the causes of rare causes of the diseases, and this study is strong for this purpose. So with the help of this study, we can investigate the rare causes. But to prove the causation of the disease, these studies are very moderate. As I have already told you, the case control studies and cohort studies, these are moderate studies for causation of the disease. The strongest study is the experimental study design. With the help of this study, we can involve the primary. Madam, you want to say something? With the help of primary data as well as the secondary data, we can conduct the cohort study. In other study designs, you may be required some particular type of data. Now, how will be the research questions in the case control as well as in the cohort study? Because research question is much more important in the research process, because we have to solve this question and ultimately we have to answer this research question. So in the case control or in the cohort study, the research question be like this: do certain factors really associate with the problem? Please mute your mics. Because we want to study the factors which are responsible for the disease, just like causes. Causes are causing the disease. So we are trying to find out the association between the causes and the disease. So the research question be like this. In case of the cohort study only, we can frame the research question like this. What is the cause of the problem? Problem means disease. Here is an example. Assuming that the antioxidants may prevent the cardiovascular disease. So on this topic, we can design the case control study as well as we can design the cohort study. So the research question will be, are antioxidants useful in prevention of cardiovascular diseases? The only difference is that we have to make the inquiry in different direction. In case control, the inquiry will be in the backward direction, and in the cohort, the inquiry will be in the forward direction. Shall I proceed? This is the next part of the study. Now we have finished the analytical study designs. Data collection. Data collection starts from the first step of the research. When we start, or when we think to start about the research, the process of data collection, it begins. The data mainly is of two types: primary data and secondary data. Primary data is the data which is collected by the researcher himself for the conduction of the study for the first time, and the secondary data is the already available data which can be collected from the different sources. So the primary data collection methods involve the observation method, secondly interview method, next is the questionnaire method, and second is the schedules method. The collection of secondary data can be from the government records, published government records, published reports of the government agencies and offices from country and from the abroad countries. Then the published journals, the data can be collected from the published books, magazines, newspapers. Then public records can be utilized as a secondary data. Then historical documents are also considered as secondary data. And the information collected from the different websites, that is also considered as the secondary data. These are the other methods of data collection which are used and which are employed in the other sectors like business and commercial purposes. So we are not going in details. In the medical science, we are having the data collection from our sources, like the medical sources. So for the these are the main sources in the medical statistics, like experiments, surveys and records. So in our PG research studies or in the PhD research studies or in the clinical practice, we are using this kind of things for the data collection. In the experiments, we are having the information related to the physiology lab, biochemistry, pharmacology, clinical pathology, as well as the information from the hospital wards. And all these information, it is utilized for the preparation of dissertation, thesis, and publication of the research papers. Then we have surveys. So the surveys are the epidemiological studies which are conducted in the field and which are conducted for the operational research. And this information collected in these surveys, it is utilized to provide the useful information on the changing trends, the morbidity rate, mortality rate, nutritional status, investigation hazards. Again, this provide feedback expected to modify the health policies and the system and lead to redefine objects. This type of information provide timely warning of public health hazards. Means in the health department, this type of information is utilized for making new policies and for making and for modifying the old policies. So on having the reports of this particular researches, health policies are modified or changed. The records are the registers or which are maintained as a routine in our hospitals, clinics, the books which are over long period in for utilized for various purposes, they contribute to the records. So in the vital statistics, we collect the birth data, we collect the marriage data, the death data is also collected, illness in hospital is also collected. So all these information again is utilized for the development of the country. Even in research, we can take the references of this data. Next is the data analysis. When we want to do the data analysis, once we have started the research and collected the data, after finishing the data analysis, data collection, we have to conduct data analysis. And this step is very important. Though it is later on, but we have to think before the start of the study. Means when you want to start the study, you will have to think about the future. Means we have to think in the forward direction when you want to conduct the data analysis. So the data analysis is related with the data collection. So while choosing the methods of data collection, you have to also think about the data analysis methods. So this is a process of systematically applying statistical as well as logical techniques to describe and illustrate, condense and recap and evaluate the data. Though the terms are very big and quite looks quite difficult, all these things are we are doing routinely. In the PG researches, in the PhD researches, in the faculty researches, we are doing the research and we are collecting the data, as well as we are doing the analysis, we are doing statistical analysis, and also we are having the inferences and conclusion from our research. Only the thing is, the terms are new, or we are observing the terms for the first time, or it may be routine for some people. But the things are very simple. So in the data analysis, what is the first thing that comes in the mind? When we see the data, it is very raw data. Means after the collection of the data, in front of us, we are having only the raw data. Now, we have to convert that raw data into a systematic pattern, into a systematic form, so that we can estimate, or we can find out, or we can interpret a particular pattern, or we can interpret connections between two factors, two variables, two attributes, and we can explain the relationship between cause and disease. We can explain the relationship between the causes and the risk factors. We can explain the relation between risk factors and the disease, like that. So for drawing some inferences, for drawing some conclusion, we have to analyze the data. So after the analysis, we are going to give a meaningful insight to the raw data. These are some considerations in the data analysis. The researcher should have necessary skill to analyze the data. This is very important. The data collection method should be proper, because if the data collection methods are wrong, then your data analysis will also be wrong. Manner of presenting the data, the presentation of different kinds of data, the primary data, secondary data, they are presented in different ways according to the type of research and according to the available data. So we can use tabulation method, we can use graph method, we can use the pie diagrams and all these. So for different types of data, we can use different types of presentation methods. Data recording method. Just like data collection method, we should choose the proper data recording method. Whether we have to conduct the interview, or whether we have to conduct the survey, whether we can use the schedule method. So it should be appropriate. If it is appropriate, the next procedure will be appropriate. Then the most important issue regarding the data analysis is reliability and validity of the data. The data collected should be reliable and it should be validated. Means it should be valid. If it is reliable and valid, then your hard work or your attempts to analyze the data will not be फ्रूटलेस. अगर आपका डाटा ही वैलिड नहीं है, आपका डाटा ही रिलायबल नहीं है, तो आपका पूरा एनालिसिस वेस्ट जाएगा. उसके लिए आपका जितना भी मेहनत है, जितना भी आपका हार्डवर्क उसमें लग रहा है, दैट विल बी वेस्टेड. सो इन दिस टॉपिक वी आर गोइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड अबाउट द डाटा प्रिपरेशन. इन दैट we will see how to validate the data, what is data editing, what is data coding. Secondly, we will see the data analysis methods for quantitative type of data as well as qualitative type of data. The aim of the data preparation is to convert the raw data into the meaningful and readable data, because when we publish a research paper or when we publish our research report, it should be understandable for everyone. The reader may be a scientific person, the reader may be a statistician, the reader may be a common or layman. And your report should be understandable by all kinds of people. The common person or the layman, they cannot understand the statistical language. When you are conducting a research on the efficacy of the disease, efficacy of your drug, then your ultimate statement should be, or your conclusion should be, whether that drug is efficacious in the particular disease or not. if you are saying the drug is significantly efficacious, then that significance cannot be understood by the common person. So for that purpose, we have to convert all the material in particular meaningful as well as particular readable format. And for that purpose, we have to follow these steps. So first step is the data validation. In this data validation, we to find out whether data collection was done as per the preset standards and without any bias. Means your data collection should be proper. And to check whether you have collected the data properly or not, according to the methodology, according to the study design, this data validation step is involved. In every step of the research study, we have to avoid the bias and we have to follow the standards of the research. So for this purpose, we have four steps, which includes the detection of fraud, which includes the screening, which includes the procedure, and which includes the completeness of the documents. So for this purpose, we have to check whether the each and every respondent was interviewed or not. In any kind of survey, in any kind of research, every participant should get equal chance. That is why we are selecting the representative sample, and each participant should be contacted and his information should be collected individually. Then in the selection process of the research, we have to use some sampling techniques so that the bias can be avoided and your sample becomes representative. Because at the end of the research, we are generalizing the results of the study. Means the results of the studies are applicable to the whole population, and for that purpose we need a representative sample, and for this our screening should be proper according to the research criteria. Then the procedure for the data collection should be proper, and whatever the method is used for collecting the data, just like interview method or any questionnaire method or any schedule method is used, in that case we have to complete all the documents. Means the questionnaire should be completely filled at the same time, or the schedule should be completely filled. All the questions should be asked to the participants, and all the answers to the questions should be received from the participants, and they are duly filled in the questionnaire. Next step is data editing. Please keep in mind that data editing is not manipulation of the data. In the research, manipulation is not allowed. Only we are editing the data, because most of the time all the questions are not asked to the participants, or there are some empty fields which are not filled properly, or some information which is not collected properly. So we have to complete that task. So that is involved in the data editing. So while doing this procedure, we have to check for outliers. Outliers are the observations which are very, very different from the routine observations. If you have collected the information regarding the hemoglobin of the participants, and one participant is having very less hemoglobin, just like two or three, so that kind of observation becomes outlier, and that will change your mean value, that will change your standard deviation, that will affect the result of the study. So in this procedure, we have to first check for the outliers, and then we have to edit the raw research data to identify and clear out any data points that may hamper the accuracy of the results. Means your observation should be proper, and if they are not proper, you have to justify. If any outlier is there, you have to give reason for that outlier. You have to give some justification for that outlier. Why this different reading is occurred? So while editing the data, it is important to make sure to remove or fill all the empty fields. Next step is the data coding, and this is the most important steps in the data preparation. In this step, we are doing nothing, just we are categorizing our data. So we have to create some buckets or some group, and accordingly the data is categorized. For example, the participants are grouped according to the age, according to the sex, according to the religion, according to their occupation, according to their economical status and all. So during this analysis, the researcher can deal with the simplified category, and this simplified category is going to help us for the further process. Next is the analysis methods for the quantitative type of data. Just like primary and secondary data, the other two types of data are quantitative data and qualitative data. The quantitative data is measurable data, and the qualitative data is non-measurable, non-numerical type of data. So whatever the measurable data is there, for the analysis of this data, there are two different methods, like descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. Once again, I must tell you, these terms are looking very huge or big, but we are already familiar with this. The descriptive statistics, it is also called as descriptive analysis, and it helps researchers to summarize the data and finding the patterns. So the descriptive statistics is nothing but it is the analysis which carries out the involvement of measures of central tendency as well as measures of the dispersion. So measures of central tendency are mean, median and mode, and the measures of dispersion are range, mean deviation and standard deviation. So all these parameters will be discussed in the statistical part. The descriptive statistics provides absolute numbers. After calculating mean, we get a number. After calculating the range, we get a number. So however, these do not explain the rationally reasoning behind the numbers. How these numbers have occurred or what these numbers mean, this cannot be explained by these numbers. Only the numbers are there. So before applying descriptive studies, it is important to think about which one is the best suited for your research question and what you want to show. Means if you want whether to use mean, median or mode, it depends upon the type of data, whether it is qualitative or quantitative. And again, it depends upon the type of research, which kind of research you are conducting, whether it is descriptive research, whether it is experimental research, whether it is analytical research, and what is your research question, what you want to prove, what is your aim. So all these things are considered for selecting the descriptive statistics. Second is the inferential statistics. Inferential statistics is nothing but after finishing the statistical analysis or after finishing the data collection and data analysis, we apply some statistical test to test your hypothesis, to draw the result, to draw the inferences, and we apply some parametric and non-parametric test. So all that involves in the inferential statistics. Inferential statistics are used to generalize result. Means in a representative sample, we have conducted the study and we have obtained some results in that particular group. Now, the results obtained for that particular groups, they are generalized for the population of that particular disease. And for that purpose, we need these inferential statistics. These are complex analyses that show the relationship between several different variables. In our study, we have more than two variables. Just like before and after the study, we check hematological parameters, we check biochemical parameters, we check other parameters like CRP and all. For different type of studies, we have different variables. And to establish or to estimate the relationship between these variables, between the drug and the variables, we have to interpret that data. And for that purpose, this inferential statistics is going to be helpful. Types of inferential analysis. The first method is used is the correlation analysis. In the inferential analysis, the first method is the correlation analysis. Correlation means there is a relationship between two variables. This type of analysis is going to help us to describe the relationship between two variables. And if a correlation is found, it means that there is a relationship between the variables. Most of the time, the relationship between two variables is in only one direction. Just like this example is given, in a research study, it is found that taller people have a higher weight. The taller people have long bones, the length of bone is increased, and accordingly the weight also increases. So here we can establish the relationship between, or we can correlate the two parameters or two variables, height and weight. So we can correlate them with each other. But it is not necessarily that if someone gains the weight, then his or her height should be increased. Means this is a one-way correlation. So this type of correlation is used in the inferential analysis. Secondly, regression analysis. Regression means some kind of losses, some kind of decrease. It can be explained with the help of regression analysis. Here also we are going to estimate the relationship between two variables. Just like if you want to guess the weight depending upon the height, in that case you can use the regression analysis to guess the weight of the participant. Analysis of variance. You must have heard in the statistical test. This is a parametric test which we call as ANOVA, analysis of variance. Most of the time this test is used when there are two or more groups in the same experiment. Second condition is that when we assess any parameter at particular interval, in that case also we have to apply this analysis of variance. So when in the experiment we find some significant findings or significant result, we have to check whether this significance is statistically significant or it is due to random chance. Means we have to check the probability whether this difference occurring is statistically significant or not. So for that purpose we have to use this analysis of variance. Most of the time the difference may be by chance, the difference may be random, or at times the difference may be, if it is too much high, it is may be statistically significant. So proving the hypothesis, we have to explain our results on the basis of statistical test. The last part is the analysis of the qualitative data. Qualitative data is the data which is having some words of quality, some observations of quality, some images, even some symbols. They are also used in the study. And they are not countable, they are not measurable. So here there is no numerical data. So analysis of such kind of data is quite difficult. But for that purpose, we have to use the descriptive statistics like median and mode. They are used. So in this preparation and data analysis of the qualitative data, both the processes are conducted simultaneously in parallel to each other, and the steps are followed in the parallel. So when we want to analyze the qualitative data, if you are conducting any qualitative study, just like fundamental study or basic research, in that case you have to get familiar with the data. Means whatever the data you have collected, you have to read that data several times, and while reading you have to look for some observations and some patterns. What kind of observations are different than the existing knowledge? What kind of patterns are different from the existing knowledge? And simultaneously you have to write the data, you have to write the pattern, you have to write the observations which are different. Next step is revisiting reviews. Means while reading the research data, you have to keep in mind your what are your objectives. Because in the last step, you have to answer your objectives. All the answers of the objective should be received from your research project. And for that purpose, we have to take care of our objectives so that they should be completely fulfilled and completely answered. So while reading the collected data, we have to check whether we can get the answer of the objective. If you are getting the objective, answer of the objective, you have to write it down. Next step is developing a framework. This step is also known as coding or indexing. In qualitative data also we have seen the coding of the data. The procedure is same, only the data is different. So here you have to find out some broad ideas. I will give an example. You have to find out some concepts, some behaviors, some phrases, and then you have to assign some code to that particular selected ideas. Just like coding, like age of the participants, gender of the participants, socioeconomic status, and even concepts can be coded as positive and negative. If you are having interview and in which you are asked some questions and you have received some answers in the yes no form, in the positive negative sense, you can code them like that. So this kind of coding is helpful in structuring and labeling the data. So while preparing the master chart, this type of coding will be quite helpful. Next is the identifying patterns and connections. Whatever the data you have coded, once the coding procedure is completed, the researcher can start identifying the themes. And then you have to look for the most common responses to the questions. Whatever the answers you have received from the questionnaire, you have to find out the common answers, and then the answers can be categorized. Secondly, the data or pattern of that particular answers can be identified, so that in the last phase of the research, we can find some areas which can be explored for the further research. Means if you are conducting a basic research on the Avaran, you will collect the available material which is present in the Sanhita regarding Avaran, Avaran Chikitsa, and you will try to find out some different things considering today's arena, considering the clinical practice which is conducted in today's era. You will find out how this Avaran concept will be helpful in the clinical practice, in the treatment of the diseases. And if you find that on this particular arena, the further research should be conducted, you can explore that particular area. Now, the qualitative data analysis method. There are few methods which are used for the analysis of the qualitative data. Literally, here we are analyzing the quality of the data. The first method is the content analysis. Content analysis means whatever the documentation you have done in your study, you have to analyze the content, you have to analyze the documented information from your study. This is the most common method which is used in the qualitative data. Not even documented information, but you can use the text, you can use the media, you can use the physical forms, and you can analyze them. This kind of method is also helpful to analyze the responses of the interviews in which a questionnaire is used, or in which the interview is taken in the form of question and answer, or if you can take interview telephonically. All these things can be analyzed with the help of this content analysis. Second is the narrative analysis. In some of the surveys or some field surveys, just like ethnobotanical surveys are there, in which the researcher is going to the field and asking the villagers some questions, some sharing some experiences with them, collecting the experiences of that villagers, having some conversation with the villagers. So in such type of studies, the researcher receives the information in the narrative form, in the form of stories, in the form of experiences. So for that purpose, all these type of stories, all these type of experiences, or the observations collected from the field, observations collected from the surveys, answers received from the respondents, if they are in the narrative form, they should be analyzed. And the narrative analysis helps in such situation. Please mute your mics. Next method is the discourse analysis. In some type of researches, we are having the interactions with the people. We are having communication with the participants. Even the communication is in the form of their day-to-day activities, their living environment, and all such information is collected. And with the help of this discourse analysis, we have to analyze the information which is received from the interaction with the participants. And the last method for the qualitative analysis is the grounded theory. Grounded theory is used when you want to explain any event, when you want to explain some mechanism, when you want to explain some phenomena, how this phenomena occurred, why this phenomena occurred. In that case, this grounded theory is going to be helpful. So when the study needs explanation or the causes of some process, causes of some phenomena, in that case, whatever the data is collected, that data is analyzed with the help of this grounded theory. But to draw some conclusion from this kind of grounded theory, we need more cases. Means the participant should be more, because every participant will have his own experience. Every participant will have his own explanation. And coming to a conclusion needs more evidences. And for that purpose, we should have more cases which will give you common explanation or common causes. And on the basis of that evidences, a researcher can give a conclusion with the help of this grounded theory. I hope you have understood all these things. These are some references, and I acknowledge all these authors of the books of research methodology who have contributed well in the field of research. If you have any question, you can ask regarding this presentation. Thank you.
Participants, if you have any query or doubt, please unmute yourself and ask. Any query or doubts? Okay. Myself, Dr. Leena Gautam, PG scholar of Panchkarma Department of Ayurveda and Unani Tibya College and Hospital. I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Nilima Narayan Rao Wadnirwar, ma'am, for enlightening us with their knowledge about analytical study, data collection, and data analysis. It provides some interesting points. And lastly, on behalf of the Panchkarma department, I would like to express my gratitude to all the participants for patiently listening to this webinar. This event would have been impossible without the support of each and everyone present here. Tomorrow, the session will be started on the same time from 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Nilima.
Thank you. Thank you to the organizers.
Thank you.